Good morning and welcome to worship here with St. Thomas United Church along with Foothills United Church. As each week we gather for worship, we recognize the sacredness of this space. We recognize that this is Treaty 7 land upon which we live and work and play. The traditional territory of the Kainai, the Piikani, Siksika, Stony Nakoda, and the Tsuut'ina Nation. And we include the Métis Region 3 of Alberta. In acknowledging this land, we call ourselves to live with respect in creation and in right relationship with all its peoples. We understand that this means structural and personal change, and we work towards a time of right relations for us and one another. As we begin our worship this morning, we light our Christ candle. We light this candle recognizing Christ's light of love in our own lives and in the spaces between us as we gather for worship. Let us begin with our introit, Voices United, number 291, All Things Bright and Beautiful. We'll sing verses 2 and 5. Join us in song.
All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, in love God made them all. The purple-headed mountains, the river running by, the sunset, brightens up the sky. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful, in love God made them all. God gave us eyes to see them, that we might tell. How great is God, our Maker, who has made all things well. All things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small, all things wise and wonderful,
Please join us in our call to worship this morning. Your part is in yellow. The ground on which we walk is imbued with the divine. May we see that God is here, in our midst and beside us on our path. For this is holy ground, and we are a holy people. Amen. Please continue with me in prayer in our opening prayer. Let us pray together. Holy God, you walk this path with us in each step and in each journey. Help us to see your place along the way, in the hills we climb and in the valleys we traverse, in the pinnacle views from mountain grandeurs and the sheer cliff faces that we cannot help but fear. Help us to know you are with us, waiting for us to call on your name. Be with us as you have been with your people throughout the ages. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning, Voices United, number 421. Lead on, O cloud of presence. Let us sing together.
Scripture reading this morning is from Exodus chapter 14, verses 19 to 31. Then the angel of God, who had been traveling in front of Israel's army, withdrew and went behind them. The pillar of cloud also moved from in front and stood behind them, coming between the armies of Egypt and Israel. Throughout the night, the cloud brought darkness to the one side and light to the other side. So neither went near the other all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and all that night the Lord drove the sea back with a strong east wind and turned it into dry land. The waters were divided, and the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground, with a wall of water on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued them, and all Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen followed them into the sea. During the last watch of the night, the Lord looked down from the pillar of fire and cloud at the Egyptian army and threw it into confusion. He jammed the wheels of their chariots so they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, "Let's get away from the Israelites. The Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the waters may flow back over the Egyptians and their chariots and horsemen." Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at daybreak the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing toward it, and the Lord swept them into the sea. The water flowed back and covered the chariots and horsemen, the entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not one of them survived. But the Israelites went through the sea on dry ground with a wall of water on their right and on their left. That day the Lord saved Israel from the hands of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the mighty hand of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, the people feared the Lord and put their trust in him and in Moses, his servant. This is the witness of the church. Thanks be to God.
I have to say that for a good portion of us, when we read this text, we have numerous images of Charlton Heston and Yul Brynner in Cecil B. DeMille's 1956 classic, The Ten Commandments. Heston truly became the iconic image of Moses for multiple generations after that movie. I watched that movie yearly with my mom around the Easter season, and for me, at a young age, this movie brought the story of the Exodus account to life. However, while the movie was and still is able to emote real emotion around the characters in the story, it still is a 1956 classic, and therefore is limited in its ability to portray the graphicness of this account. In addition, when we ourselves read scripture, we have culturally developed a practice of hearing these stories in a sanitized way. The story of Moses and Exodus is anything but a safe story. And the horrors of this account begins in the opening passages of the book of Exodus, when Pharaoh looks to systematically and violently oppress and destroy the Israelite people by ordering all the male babies born killed and the rest of the population enslaved. Through the bravery of women, Moses is spared. We like to stop at that triumphal moment. But how many more women were not so fortunate? Then we have Moses, who commits murder and needs to flee. We gloss over this to get to the next part. But what lasting impacts does this have on a person? The 10 plagues of Egypt are devastating and heart-wrenching when you think about the Egyptian people affected by them. And then you have this terrifying account of the powerful Egyptian army, the symbol of those that had oppressed, descending on the Israelite people who had nowhere to go and were trapped by the sea. DeMille's movie is not able to capture the true chaos of the Red Sea crossing, nor does it capture the devastation of the bodies of Pharaoh's soldiers on the shoreline. A reminder, once again, that both sides had people who suffered tragedy because of a tyrant. A close reading of the Exodus account should make us uncomfortable. Yet this passage and this account is a story of creation. The imagery and language used in the passage would have reminded the original hearers of the opening passages of Genesis, the first story of creation. God hovering over the chaos, a strong wind, the parting of water, and the appearance of land are all stories of creation and creation themes. Casey Sigmund, assistant professor of preaching at St. Paul's School of Theology, writes regarding the entirety of this drama, Yahweh has one last miracle to perform, one that would forever establish the God of the Israelites, establish that the God of the Israelites had power over two great enemies, chaos and tyranny. God is creating a new identity for the Israelite people, no longer that of slaves, yet this new beginning requires an ending. This is not to make justification for the violence of this account, but as Anita Porter Young, associate professor of Old Testament at Duke University, writes, though there is light in this new creation, there's also darkness. The passage portrays slavery's end in vivid, violent detail. It shows the end result of an economy built on forced labor, exploitation, and domination. In light of recent stories in the media, we recognize that our history of colonialism is still at work in our structures and biases. We also recognize that slavery still occurs in our world today in numerous ways. Even if the language in some cases is framed around indebtedness and fair wages, oppression and exploitation still occur. And the effort to dismantle is not easy work. We are complicit in so many ways, but there is no quick fix. Discussion around it will make us uncomfortable and perhaps even defensive. It will make our hearts ache, and it will challenge our individual and corporate identities. This is the birthing pain of creation, and the process takes time. Yet this is also a story of faith. As the Spirit of God blows in our lives, we travel along newly exposed land that lays bare the desolation around us, and we need to pay attention. As Christians, we have been called to a new identity in Christ. This identity is the same as the God of the Israelites who fought against chaos and tyranny. And this should remind us that our faith is not one that is meant to soothe our discomfort. As we travel along the newly exposed reality of this time in our history, especially as we engage with things like human rights issues, systematic racism, and climate change, we rely on God to help provide a way through the chaos. Our faith should be transformative. We are called to take notice of the devastation of our own practices and to allow the Creator to challenge us to make changes that allow for all of creation to flourish. We've all experienced moments in our lives when we realize that the process of becoming is hard and painful. Yet this is the life that we have been called into. Thankfully, our scripture continuously reminds us that this is a journey. And over the next few weeks, we will continue to walk with the Israelite people on their story of transformation and recreation, from a group of slaves to a nation of God's people. There will be times when they rebel because the future is unknown. And there are times when they show great faith. And the journey is full of ups and downs. For me, I hear this reality of imperfection as good news. Because despite everything, God ultimately is still there every step along the way. It's going to take time for the Israelite people to fully embrace their new identity. The initial freedom that occurred in this morning's passages is only the beginning, and the process is going to take generations for the Israelite people. When I look at our context today, I hope this means that we will not shy away from continuing to engage with conversation and action around right relations, racism, sexism, homophobia, transphobia, and exploitation of our neighbors. That we won't shy away because it's inconvenient or because we feel like the conversation is done. When we do this, we fail to listen and take seriously those who say that we still have work to do, and we communicate that their experience is not of importance. We fail to take notice of the human cost of all people, no matter if we see ourselves in the story as the oppressor or the oppressed. The work of creation is still at play in the world. How will we let our faith in a God of love who formed all of creation and said that it was good continue to work in our lives? How will we learn from our history and continue to build upon the work that others have laid out before us? How will we navigate the land we travel on right now, one that exposes the ways that we have intentionally or unintentionally rebelled against this work? What will we take notice of at this time in our history before the waters rush back in? This is the work of creation that we've been called into. Until God's love and peace is known to all, the journey might be long. But let us take faith that we are not alone. Amen.
We recognize the gifts of God's people that enable the work of the church both in our community and in the world. We celebrate the giving of your treasure, but also acknowledge the giving of your time and your talent. We give thanks for all those that continue to support the work of both churches, both St. Thomas and Foothills United Churches, through continuing to mail your donations to the churches and by participating in the pre-authorized remittance giving program. I would invite anyone else who would like to support this community of faith to do so through the Donate Now button on St. Thomas's website. Let us pray together. Holy One, we give thanks for your place among us, for your gifts along the roads of life that have shown us the way forward. Be with us as we do what we are able to help others along their path. Help us to use the gifts we have been given to aid against obstacles, overcome adversity, and accompany others along their journeys in our community and around the world. Amen. Please join with us as we prepare our hearts for prayer, as we sing our call to prayer, Voices United 595, verses 3 and 4 of We Are Pilgrims. Join with us.
Light for you in the night time of your fear.
come to this time of prayer as those who live in memory and hope of the story of creation, where God draws us up from the soil into life. With that memory in mind, we come now to pray to the God who works recreation and redemption from the ground up. Let us pray. Hear our prayers, loving Creator, for our gratefulness of this land. For the power of the earth and the nourishment of the soil, we give great thanks. For the safety Mother Earth gives us in sustaining our food, and the comfort she gives us as we all return to her blanket of care at the end of our lives. Hear our prayers, loving Creator, for all who wander across many lands in search of home, for refugees, the homeless, those in search of a job, challenged by addictions, and those with mental health struggles. Hear our prayers, loving Creator, for all who work to protect Earth. Stir in us a willingness to speak and act beyond the safety of conversation and study groups for the sake of your good creation. Hear our prayers, loving Creator, for the faithfulness of the Church. May our practices of and relationships with the land as individuals and congregations be in keeping with the values of your vision. Hear our prayer, loving Creator, for eyes and spirits open to your presence, even in those shadowed lands. You accompany us upon the way. You bring healing. You wait upon us. You love us with a love that will not let us go. As we hold our focus on the land and strive to take care of her as she takes care of us, we hold her in our prayers and add her to the prayers we have of others on our hearts. We pray in order to bring to the forefront the burdens on our hearts and those situations that are beyond our control. We have held many people in prayer over the summer, and we name them aloud now. We pray for all those who are grieving the loss of a loved one, including most recently Cheryl, Maxine, Melinda Ray, Dorothy, Betty, David, Deirdre, Dave, Greg, Barry, Carolyn, and their families. We pray for all those burdened and worried about loved ones' illnesses or surgery, and for those recovering and for those still waiting test results and treatment. For Harold, Andrea, Luca, Jackie, Tammy, Summer, Caitlin, Janet, and her mom, Angie, Linda, Marion, Rick, Catherine, Betty Ann, Lynn, Beth, Nada, Tony, John, Diane, Mary, Richard, Amy, Will, Maureen, Gunther, and all their families. We pray for all those moving, attending, or working at schools, and those who are more isolated than ever due to the current pandemic. And we pray for all those we know and don't know with COVID-19, including Margaret, Anita, Carolyn's cousin, and auntie. And on this Grandparents' Day, we hold in prayer all grandparents and their grandchildren, knowing that there is a special bond between them. We continue to name those heavy on our minds, and we know that in the following silence, all names are heard and burdens lightened. We know you hear all our prayers, loving Creator, and continue praying together by singing the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
Spirit that is blowing night and day. Travel on with the Spirit that is blowing. The Spirit will be with us all the way. Travel on with the river that is flowing. The Spirit will be with us all the way. Travel on, there's a Spirit that is growing. The Spirit grows our flowers night and day. Travel on with the Spirit that is growing. The Spirit will be with us all the way. Travel on with the flower that is growing. The Spirit will be with us all the way. Travel on, there's a Spirit that is playing. The Spirit plays like music every day.
Let's join responsively in the commissioning. Your part is in yellow. In hearing of God's place in our places, in seeing the holy in our midst, may we proclaim the divine in each step, in each outstretched arm, and in each life we meet. For we are God's people, and this is God's land. Amen. And now, let us take our leave of this space of worship, remembering that God travels with us, guiding us by the Holy Spirit to follow the ways of Christ. Amen.
This great big world before me, but it's all for someone else. I've tried and tried again to let you know just where my heart is, to tell the truth and not pretend. All I needed was to get away, just to realize that I was meant to stay, where the mountains sing through the screams of seagulls, where the whales can't live, 'cause the gentle people in my hometown, my hometown, thought it made it clear. Do I have to sing it? It was always there, we just didn't see it. Now I I know what makes me happy, and I can tell you feel it too. With a mountain sea, through the screams of seagulls, where the whales can't live, 'cause the gentle people